Welcome to today's broadcast. I am sure you will be blessed at the end of this broadcast. Please stay tuned.
I will speak on what I titled from a burden mentality to a bone. Bone has parentheses. From a burden mentality to a bone mentality. What does a bone signify? Bone signifies structure. Bone signifies strength. From a burden, you know, I hear many Christians talk about, you know, the burdens they carry for the kingdom. But if you look all through scripture, God doesn't want us to celebrate our burdens. If not, he will not give us such scriptures as Matthew 11 and verse 30. For my yoke is what? Easy. And my burden is what? Light. So he doesn't want us to dwell so much on the burden we'll carry. Because you know, God knows that he has given us the grace to do what we do. Paul was speaking in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 10. He said that, you know, I am the least of all the apostles. You know, I carry certain burdens. You know, I do certain things, but yet not I that does it. But what? The grace of God in me. So Paul was celebrating the grace to labor more. He was not celebrating the burden he was carrying. A lot of Christians celebrate, I'm carrying too much. No, you don't begin to celebrate your burdens. Praise the Lord. You celebrate the strength God has given to you. You celebrate the positives. You celebrate the advantages that make you do what you do. Because in the first place, if God does not help you, you will not be able to do what you are doing. So sometimes we'll celebrate the grace of God upon our lives. Sometimes we'll have to celebrate the hand of God upon our lives. Of course, sometimes this is burdensome. At a particular point, you know, Moses complained that he was about the only one that did what he did. And God had to tell him to raise what? 70 what? Elders. Why? Because God doesn't want us to keep complaining about certain things. At a particular instance too, you know, a particular prophet, Elijah, 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 10, complained to God that I am the only one that is left. I'm the only one that carried this burden. God does not want you. Let me tell you, this word was given to me by God. For I don't know why I'm even preaching what I'm preaching. Because I am supposed to even tell you things that will what? Enervate you, things that will stir you up. But the Lord says you share this word. In case you are here, you're complaining about the burdens you carry. The Lord says you tell you it's a privilege for you to carry certain burdens. There's a grace upon your life to do what you do. That's why you are saddled with responsibilities. That's why the Bible talks about Jesus in Isaiah chapter 9, that the government shall be what? Upon his shoulder. That's a symbol of burden. And of the increase of his government, there shall be no what? End. And the zeal, somebody says zeal. The zeal of the Lord, the passion of the Lord shall perform it. So God wants us not to complain about the burdens we carry for the kingdom, because there's a grace associated with doing what we are doing. So when God gives you that privilege to carry certain burdens, rather than complain about the burdens you carry, begin to celebrate the grace God has given to you. Somebody shout an hallelujah. I really want scripture. It is one of the scriptures I will lay a foundation with and just run. You know, on this trip, we're on a trip. Tell your neighbor, we're on a trip. You know, Judges chapter 15 and verse 14. Praise the Lord. Somebody shout hallelujah. God is about to lift one of you here out of the doldrums of depression and is about to establish you upon the rock to stay. You know, upon the rock to stay. Upon the rock to stay. Like David said, he has delivered me from sinking sand and set my feet upon the rock to stay. I sense that someone here is about to receive his promotion. Maybe in the place of your work, God is about to lift you to your next level. You are about to stand upon that rock. There's a rock that will make sure that you are no longer hidden. People will see you and know that you have been lifted. This promotion coming your way will not be hidden again in the name of Jesus. And when he came unto Lehi, the Philistines shouted against him. And the spirit, mark that spirit is in capital letter, of the Lord came mightily upon him. And the cords that were upon his arms became as flax. In other words, the cords became feeble, that was burned with fire, and his bands loosed from off his hand. Follow me closely, verse 15. And the Bible says, and he found a new jawbone. You see where I got the topic for this message. Amen? Where I got the topic from, you know, from what? A burden mentality to what? A bone mentality. The bone is a symbol of strength. You can also say from a burden mentality to a strength mentality. Now, anytime you see an ass, is called a donkey. Donkey is another name. So donkeys, when they are alive, their mouths are usually bridled. Is it not so? So bridling the mouth of the donkey meant that the donkey is not, you know, meant to use his mouth effectively. In fact, it was called a beast of burden. Somebody said the beast of burden. So donkeys were meant to carry burdens. So, you know, for a donkey, in fact, there's a clear message here. The Bible said that the jawbone of a donkey became more effectual at death. In other words, the donkey had to die to the mentality of being a burden and stay alive to the mentality of being a bone for it to make impact. Oh. Did you get that? The new jawbone of an axe or a donkey put forth his hand and took it. Now look at it. And slew what? 1,000 men. Ordinarily, donkeys were not meant to fight battles. They were beasts of burden. In fact, if you see a donkey in contemporary times, most times their mouths were bridled. Is it not so? You have things that cover their mouth. So, you know, when a donkey is alive to being a burden carrier, amen, it is not used for warfare. It took the donkey to die for his jawbone to become effectual in slaying 1,000 men. So the donkey had to die to the mentality of being a burden and stay alive to the mentality of being what? A bone or a strength, so that it can make impact. That's why I got the topic that many Christians need to realize that they need to jettison the mentality of burden, being burden carriers, and live or stay alive or rise up to the mentality of being people who are privileged to do what they're doing for the kingdom. The mentality of people who are strong to make impact, praise the Lord. Because it took the donkey to die for his jawbone to slay 1,000 people. That means the jawbone of the donkey was very strong. Because if it was a cracker biscuit jawbone or biscuit bone, it will break while you are hitting a one. So the jawbone was stronger at death. Tell your neighbor, die to the mentality of being a burden carrier and rise up to the mentality of being a strong Christian. Praise the Lord. Amen. That is when you make more impact. So the Bible said, and he took it and slew 1,000 men therewith. Verse 16. I'm going to read to verse 20. And Samson said, with the jawbone of an ass, heaps upon heaps, with the jaw of an ass, have I slain what? 1,000 men. He made impact. Very, very powerful statement. Now, verse 17, the Bible says, and it came to pass, when he had made an end of what? Speaking, that he cast away what? The jawbone. In other words, he felt that the jawbone was useless. And out of his hand, and called that place Ramat what? Lehi. And he was what? Sore at thirst. Is it not surprising that sometimes when we do some things for the kingdom of God that have made impact, many of us become sore at thirst. Many of us become weary in doing what we're doing. So Samson was weary. And look at what he said, just like Elijah cried to God and said, I'm the only one left. Amen? Look at what Samson said here. And said, and called the Lord and said, thou hast given this great deliverance unto the hand of thy what? Servant. And now shall I die for what? First. Probably he thought that the Lord would bring another jawbone or maybe tell him, point to a well to him. But no, the Lord didn't do that. And fall into the hand of non-circumcised. Now look at verse 19. Let me land. But God clave. Mark that word, clave. The word clave, the root meaning of that word clave means to break forth. Amen? It means to open up. It means to create a gap. There are gaps that God has created in our lives that only him can fill. That's why even in the course of your commitment to God, you become thirsty. And in that thirst, only God can fill it. Now look at this. And he said, and but God clave an hollow place that was in the jaw. Somebody said the hollow place. In other words, the jawbone that he cast away also had a solution to his problems. The same gift you use in ministering to others is the same gift that God will use to bring you out of bondage. Don't minister to others and cast away your gift. thinking it's all done. Or you boast about how you're able to make impact in the life of other people. That same impact should be made in your life. Because this is a symbol of the fact that God did not, you know, let go of that jawbone. It would have been useless after slaying 1,000 men. But God was trying to pass a message here. The same jawbone that slew 1,000 men is the same jawbone that will quench your thirst. So the gift you have is the same gift that will bring a blessing to you. Somebody shout amen. Amen. If you talk about ministering to people and they are blessed and you operate in a gift of prophecy, also use that gift to be a blessing to your personal life. Because there's no way water can pass through a pipe and water will not, and the pipe will not be wet. Did you catch that? There's no way water can pass through what? A pipe. I know occasionally we have preached that your gift is not meant for you, but the Lord began to give me a higher dimension of understanding in this. No matter what you do, also minister to yourself. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 verse 1 that Jesus Christ began to what? Both do and what? Teach. In other words, what he disseminated, he also injected. Don't boast about the things you have done to better the life of others. Let it also be used with you. The same jawbone, don't cast it away. The same gift you've used to minister, don't cast it away, because that same gift that you will use to minister to yourself. I remember when we left Wolara Wolokun, a particular sister came to me and said, "Pastor, you are the one that used to preach that if the princes of this world knew, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." Immediately she told me that, it jolted me, because I had always encouraged people about, you know, if the devil knew that the things he was doing in your life was going to bring out something better in you, he would not do it. So when she told me that thing, I was healed instantly. Why? Because some of the experiences we've had in life, or some of the messages we preach, sometimes it may be for another person at that moment, but in future, there may be messages that will be beneficial to you. Some of the songs you sing, I woke up this morning feeling a little bit tired because I was battling jet lag. And one song came to me, you know, praising the Lord, praise him, in his sanctuary, praise him, in the firmament. As I began to sing that song, because it came out from the blue, as I began to sing that song, strength came to me. I just arose, because I didn't sleep until about 3 a.m. or 4, or so I thought I would sleep. I couldn't sleep. I would toss and turn, roll. I felt I shouldn't. I said, let me pray. After prayer, I was tired, I was weak, you know, and all that. Sometimes we get weakened by that, praise the Lord, because I hadn't even slept enough. But there's business to be done. Somebody shout hallelujah. Why wouldn't God reward us? Because we make tremendous sacrifices for the work. It doesn't have to be convenient for it to be a blessing. Sometimes we make sacrifices. Amen? It doesn't have to be convenient for you to be here today. Many of you came here today because you want to hear the voice of God. You want to listen up to what God is saying. Is it not so? You had convenient things to do. When I was leaving my estate, I saw people, you know, taking a walk in the morning. Yeah, they had things they could have, you know, they were taking a walk because it was their priority. Because where a man's treasure is, there lies his heart. But because you treasure the moment in his presence, you know, that's why you are here today. It's not being religious. Let me tell you, when things have assaulted you and life has assaulted you, you can just, you know, snuggle up to God because you know that your help is in the name of the Lord. Yes, sir. So nobody should tell you about being religious. You love God because men have disappointed you. Yes, things have happened to you that you no longer know who to trust. But because God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, your focus is on him. So you embrace everything that has to do with God. I told somebody, I say, am I giving to Satan? Why are you quarreling about giving? If I'm giving and it's advancing the cause of the kingdom, I will give. Don't tell me what to do with my money, praise the Lord. I will give. As long as it is against Satan, I'm going to do it. As long as it's against Satan, praise the Lord. As long as it's advancing the cause of the kingdom, I'm going to do it. So all the narratives, you know, on everybody has a personal revelation, praise God. Let me tell you something. You need to know God for yourself. Open the scriptures, let God speak to you. The word it speaks as spirit. This word is breathing. All scripture is given by, is God breathed. Someone say God breath. It is fresh. Tell your neighbor, fresh manna. Hear a word for God concerning you. Don't let anybody rule your narrative and bandy about statements that you've not proven yourself. All of a sudden, because it takes away responsibility from you, you begin to run with your narrative. But let me tell you, any gospel that does not put responsibility on you is not a true gospel. Because, you see, serving God will cost you something. Are you following what I'm saying? Serving God is going to cost you something. It's going to cost you time. It's going to cost you confidence. It's going to cost you your finances. Don't be thinking only about subsistence Christianity. There's much more God wants to accomplish with you. Are you following what I'm saying? He's a fountain. Fountain of living water means that fountains disseminate. Fountains scatter. He told the woman by the well, if you drink of the water I give to you, shall be what? A well of what? Water springing. Somebody says springing. Springing is not confined to a space. Springing means it is disseminating. Learn to have a disseminating mentality and not a subsistence mentality. Somebody shout amen. Amen. If Christianity was all about just family and all that, we will not be doing what we are doing today. We will be preaching to our family every morning. We are anointed to do that. We could preach them out of this thing. But because, you know, the way God has built you up, many of you have been built up in such ways. Your gift cannot be confined to a space. God cannot limit you to a forum. There are nations that need to hear your voice. You know, sometimes submit to the training of God. Tell your neighbor, submit to God's training. There are things that God wants to impute in you. Stop shaking yourself. Remain in humble and stay and understand the school of the Holy Spirit. Understand what God is trying to teach you. Understand that God is trying to build character in you. God wants to make you a man he can trust with certain levels of anointing and grace. And when he's taking you through that process, somebody else may not also be going through that process. And you don't let that person begin to advise you, because we all have different baptisms. We all have different walk with God. Praise the name of the Lord. So when God is taking you through a trajectory, you know, through a particular direction, there are things he wants to put in you to build a message capacity so that you can become a voice and not an echo. Many of you don't understand that there's a peculiarity about your calling. There's a hand of God upon your life. So you don't compare yourself with somebody else. That's really why God has put you where he has put you and caused you to learn the things you need to learn. God wants to invest in you. But what God wants to invest in you cannot be carried by you except you become a foundation that is able to carry that which he wants to invest in you. So humble yourself and remain steadfast in what you are doing. Focus on him. The Bible says, looking unto who? Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. By the time God builds you, you'll be like a tower. Somebody say, I'll be like a watchtower. You will indeed be like a city set upon a hill that cannot be hidden. You will be a beacon of light. You will be a beacon of light, not just to your family, but to nations around you. When God has finished with you, you'll be a beacon of light, even beyond Nigeria, to West Africa, to Africa, to the nations of the earth. That's why your experience is peculiar. That's why you are going through the challenges you are going through. That's why God is subjecting you to the process he's subjecting you to. Because there's much more he wants to do in your life. There's much more God wants to accomplish. Stop comparing yourself with somebody. There's a peculiarity about your calling. There's a hand that is upon you that another person cannot carry. There's an experience about you that somebody else has not experienced yet. Stop the comparison. There is a trajectory for your calling. There is a message God has put in your heart. There's an experience about your life. There's something that God has put upon you to enable you to ascend to the place he wants to put you in. Open yourself up and receive what God is trying to communicate. His hand is upon your life. It may not look good today, but tomorrow nations are waiting to hear your message. Nations are waiting to listen to what God is trying to communicate through you. There's a message, because God is raising you as a messenger. You must have a message, because there's something about your life. Open your mouth and say, I believe it. Say it again, I believe it. And God clave an hollow place that was in the jaw. It's called breach, B-R-E-A-C-H, a gap. Meaning that there's a gap that only God can fill. And there came water. Now, why was God? You see, a God can do a well. Bible said that when Hagar was in the wilderness, what happened? Her eyes were open and she saw a well. So anytime you see this kind of thing in scripture, it is because God is trying to communicate a revelation. That's why you need to be pensive when studying. You need to focus on the scripture and dwell sometimes to get some light. So the Bible said that God what? Cleft a hollow. This was the jaw he had thrown away. Meaning that God says this thing is still relevant, even to your own life. You are crying of thirst. What is your gift for? You are crying of thirst. What is your training for? That training is also meant to bring you to the path of victory. Don't jettison your gift. Don't always think that your gift is for somebody else. There's something that God wants to achieve through the gift he has given to you. And that's why the Bible said, and there came water there. How did water come? Miraculously. In other words, God will fulfill his part. But you are the one that will take your hand and drink the water. God is always in his word. He will speak through scripture. All scripture is given by his inspiration. But we are the ones that will open up our hearts to assimilate what God is saying. The Bible said that God clave water. Anytime we see water, water is a symbol of the word. Water is also a symbol of the spirit. And when he had drunk, his spirit came again. In other words, the same word that was used for warfare is the same word that will bring revival. In fact, the one version said that he was revived again. In fact, look at it here. He said, and he revived. Meanwhile, that jawbone was used to kill 1,000 people. So the same gift that he used to make impact is the same gift that will bring revival to you. So stop complaining or saying that you're carrying several burdens. God says, let me tell you something. Have the mentality of the bone. Because except that donkey died and that burden mentality was jettisoned, the jawbone will not be effective in slaying 1,000 men. Sometimes we need to die to the burden mentality and realize that Philippians 4:13 is not a fluke. I can do all things. Not I will do all things. I can. Somebody say, I can. I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. Look at Paul. Sometimes he was burdensome. Sometimes he faced shipwrecks. Sometimes he was whipped. Sometimes he was put in prison. But look at his mentality. His mentality was not a defeatist mentality. His mentality was not a mentality of carrying. I'm carrying so much burden. It's too much for me. The mentality Paul had was, I can do all things. And let me tell you, once you have that level of mentality, you will defeat every burden. Body will not be like any big deal to you. Praise the Lord. The bone mentality is what will make more impact. Praise God. Not the burden mentality. Somebody shout hallelujah. I can do all things. Paul was unequivocal when it came to his capabilities. I can do all things through Christ. The meaning of Christ there means the anointing. Once I am anointed, I can do it. Tell yourself, I can do it. I can go to school, do that exam, get my PhD. Let me tell you, now is the day of salvation. Don't postpone what you ought to do now, tomorrow. Determine within yourself, I can do all things. Not I will do or I could do. There was no probability in it. I can do. Have the I can do mentality. I can do all things. That is audaciousness. That is a bold audacity. That is something that people cannot handle. Sometimes when you say it like this, they will think you are boasting. But the truth is that sometimes you need to know how to boast in the Lord. Let it not be that people are only talking about your problems. There is a hand upon you. When sometimes the word says it, say the word the word says it. Let the devil go and what? Break his head with his migraine. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. There's something about you. So anytime you are speaking, speak. Everything in the word of God is meant to boost your self-esteem. The word of God is not meant to demean you. You're walking like somebody who's dragging, I'm carrying so much. And so what? The Bible says in Galatians chapter 6 verse 2, it says, bear ye the burden of one another so that you can fulfill the law of Christ. People only talk about law when it comes to tithes and offerings, isn't it? But the Bible said that the law of Christ, as a law of Christ, which means to bear one another's burdens. In other words, don't even complain. God has stationed men to bear, you know, your burden. Praise the Lord. Learn to bear the burden of the house. Learn to bear the need. When you see a need, be somebody who will be a change maker. Be somebody who can stand and make the difference. Be in a system where your impact will be felt. You are a city set upon hill. There's a reason for that. If not, the Bible said that God will not light a candle and put it under what? A covering. There's a reason why God said you are a city set upon a hill. You are the light of the world. Why? Because you are meant to, your impact is meant to be felt anywhere you are. Why? This place is well lit up. Why? Because there's light here. Is it not so? Don't you feel much better when it is lit up? It is lit up. Why? Because, you know, if there was darkness here, many of you will feel very uncomfortable. Praise God. You know, we had a program, you know, in the U.S., and somebody said, Pastor, because, you know, that place was a little bit dark, please. Let it not look, you know, very uncanny when it is dark. And they had to make it dark a little bit because of the projector screen. So I had to tell the person that was handling the projector, you know, the technical person, please let the lights be on. I don't know how you're going to do it. Because, you see, something about light. That's something about light. The entrance of the world brings what? Light. So there's something about light. You are the light of the what? World. Jesus is also the light of the world. So there's something about us. We cannot, if God is talking about light, it means that it's talking about influence. It means it's talking about impact. Because the first thing that light does is to change the atmosphere. Ask your neighbor, in what you are doing, what atmosphere have you changed? Do you know why many of us are weary? We are used to routine. Routine, no creativity. There's nothing, we're not thinking outside the box. So even what we're doing in the kingdom, every day you come and preach on Sunday and Tuesday you can preach. Do things that will challenge you. Do things that will challenge you and you can think outside the box. Praise the Lord. Do things in a different way. Amen. Don't get bored by routine. Don't get bored. You go to the office, come back, you sleep. Wake up in the morning, go to the office, come back, you sleep. Wake up in the morning, go to the office, come back, you sleep. That is a routine lifestyle. Your life is just oozing away like that. At the end of the day, you wake up one day and find out you're already 60 years. Sometimes we just need to be creative about our lives. Look for a way to enjoy yourselves. Go, if you can't afford it, go for vacation. It doesn't kill you. Vacation does not make you less spiritual. Amen. Take a rest. Go to Obudu Cattle Ranch with your spouse. There are places in Nigeria that are a blessing. I've seen some pictures of some places in Abuja. You know, go to places that can, you know, bring out, you know, rekindle the flame in you. That when you come back, you're like a brand new man. Don't be boring. Tell your neighbor, don't be boring. Husbands, please don't be boring. Wives, don't be boring. Life is not about carrying burdens. You know, the burden I carry is too much. I'm doing this one. That is not life. Sometimes awake out of your sleep because Christ has given you light. There's something about life is meant to be. When will you enjoy life? 70 years? 70-year-old man? Before you know it, you hit 70. No, enjoy your life this moment. Look good for yourself. Look at the mirror, dress well, praise the Lord. If you can afford it, look good. Look at yourself and tell yourself, I am blessed and highly favored. Not every day I'm carrying one burden. How long will you carry the burden? Please don't be carrying burden. That's what the Lord is trying to tell you today. You can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. In that your business, say, I can do all things. You know, I know I'm doing multitasking. There are many things I'm involved in, but listen to me. Begin to speak positive words about your life. Begin to declare some things that will bring, you know, the light to what you are doing and strengthen your spirit. The more you speak about positive things, the more you are, you know, energetic. The more it begins to affect you. The Bible said that a man is justified by the words of his mouth. The Bible said that by the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Do you know that the more you speak certain things, the more you are filled? Do you know why speaking in tongues is powerful? And if you don't speak in tongues, you will not be filled.
Yes, sir.
Because the more what you say is what you'll be filled with.
Yes, sir.
So if you speak the language of the Spirit, you'll be filled with the Spirit.
Yeah.
So if you speak negative things, you'll be filled with negative things. So if you speak positive things about your life, you'll be filled with what? No matter how bad things are, you are still alive.
Yes, sir.
You are still alive. Nobody will know unless you told them that you fell. Forgive yourself and move on. Put on your beautiful garment, O Zion. Arise out of the dust. Put on your beautiful garment. Loose yourself from the bands of your net. There are some deliverances that come because you've decided I'm going to set myself free. Don't continue to do as if you're carrying the burden of the whole world. You're not getting any younger. Be cheerful. Tell your neighbor, be cheerful. Tell another neighbor, be cheerful. Smile sometimes. What is your verdict? Even if they gave you a verdict, smile and say, the Lord, my Redeemer, liveth. Somebody say, my Redeemer, liveth. No matter what they say, tell them, my Redeemer, liveth. Hallelujah. When there is life, there is hope. My Redeemer, liveth. Lift up your hands and say, I believe it. Hallelujah. Put
on your beautiful garments. In other words, how can you have beautiful garments given to you from the word? And you are rolling in dust. In other words, if you don't take water from the hollow of the jawbone, you will still remain thirsty. If you don't take your beautiful garments and wear and celebrate yourself, people will only see you in the dust. And let me tell you, there's a limit to what people can do for you. Yes, celebrate yourself first. Yes, tell yourself, I am blessed. Yes, look at the mirror and say, I am beautiful. Yes, I am anointed. Do you know, I tell myself many times, I am anointed. There are contradictions in life that will question your anointing. But you need to continuously tell yourself, I am anointed. Satan, I am anointed. And nothing will stop this anointing. I am anointed. The oil is upon my head. I am anointed. God is the one that anointed me. You did not have a hand in my anointing. No matter what happens, I am anointed. Tell your neighbor, I am anointed. Tell one more person, say, I am anointed. Hallelujah. Shaya baba baba zee. Oh, Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth, there shall no more come unto thee. Now listen, this is very powerful. There shall no more come unto thee the uncircumcised. Now, do you know why he's saying that? Except you put on your beautiful garments, you will never block the uncircumcised. So you are the one that will take the word of God and chase away the negativity in your life. Stop carrying every time about your burdens. The Lord says, I should tell you, it is no big deal to me. Moses has cried. I told him, raise up 70. Elijah cried. I told him, go and anoint Jehu. Go and anoint Elisha. Go and anoint the other king. Stop complaining, because there are many people who are willing to carry what you're carrying. It's a privilege to carry what you carry. It's a privilege. That is your equation in the spirit. That is your equation. You know what glory means? Glory means weight. You can't be a man or woman of glory if you don't carry weight. It's a weight in the spirit. If you are not built to carry that kind of weight, you can't carry it. It will kill you. That's why, you know, if you are not built to carry certain levels of glory, it will not come. Because glory is weight. The glory can depart. The glory can destroy. But you must be willing to carry that glory to any time you want to carry. If you fail, forgive yourself and move forward. Christ has not sentenced you to destruction. Rise up, put on your beautiful garment, as I will no longer cry about this issue. I will not cry again about this issue. That devil is a liar. I will not cry regarding this issue again. I didn't say you should keep forward and keep confessing. Keep yourself. Because when you keep yourself, you are bold. The righteous are bold as a lion. You are bold to confront certain things. What the devil wants to do is to put certain things in your life so that it will kill your boldness. It will puncture. It will puncture your joy. So once your joy has been dealt with, it is difficult to be able to, you know, have that level of boldness. Because anytime you want to raise your voice, the enemy will say, are you raising your voice for what? Is this an acting? You're acting like the sons of Sceva? It's not here. It won't work. Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Who are you in the realm of the spirit? I can't see your address in the spirit. Who are you? You are seven sons. Did they tell you it's in numbers? A little one can become a thousand. And a small one can become a strong nation. May God send the right people your way. Yes. One person can make a difference. Yes. We started a walk in Houston. God told me that scripture. God told me that scripture. A little one shall become a thousand. What you'll be crying. Ah, Father, let's. No, one person will come out and say, I will do it. Yes, sir. The hall we're using for service, each service meeting, $2,000. If you are calculating naira, you won't do it. Yes, sir. Each service, oh. And somebody bankrolled it. Not that they want it. Let's gather and see how we can raise this money. This money has to be. Please, throw away poverty mentality. This is not village meeting. This is kingdom business. Kingdom advancers. 2,000 dong. When your head calculates in naira, you say, what? And the person didn't blink and say, Apostle, do your work. Let me do my work. That's a statement. It makes work, the work easy. Why am I flowing like anointing like this? Because there's no burden. I'm not thinking about how can I raise money to do this. No. Because those ones are solved. People are already having. God is faithful. Let me tell you. There's no prayer you pray that is useless. Just follow God. When the time comes, God will make all things beautiful in his time. There won't be any struggle. You can imagine believing God. I'm believing. You keep believing and live preparing for message. When certain things have been dealt with, you don't begin to talk about such things. Apostle, do your work. Let me do my own. Hey, that thing lifted up burden from me. I am now focused on the ministry of the word because you have to deliver. And thank goodness that in such programs, God, you know, showed up. Why? Everybody knows his part in the body. Once you know your part, it will not be a burden to you. I'm carrying so much burden. Why are you announcing it? God says, I should ask you. I don't even know why I'm saying what I'm saying. God says, I should ask you, which burden are you carrying that other people have not carried? Which burden are you carrying that other people have not carried? There are people who are doing much more. Is it not the same heaven that we are headed? How can they be begging you, you know, just give 10% of your income? Remember, you know, in the New Testament church, we are meant to give all. Let me tell you, if you don't give 10%, you can't give all. You can never give all. Because giving starts from little. That consistency and rhythm is what brings from little and it brings more. If you don't give 10%, you can't give more. I'm going to say, it's a New Testament. So that's the only law you know. What are the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus that has delivered you from the law of sin and death? What of Jesus Christ that told the disciples, give to Caesar what is what? To Caesar's tax. Pay tax to Caesar and give to God what is due to God. He told them, whose image is on this money? Give to Caesar. Does somebody thank you for paying tax? You go and pay tax to the Lagos State government, they come and thank you. I thank you so much for being able to pay your tax. Nobody thanks you for that because it's your obligation. If you don't quarrel about that level of obligation, how much more obligation towards the kingdom? Are you tithing to Satan? 10% you are quarreling. Is it the way we go? God will now invest billions on you and make you an end-time financier? Why do we have problem with money? All over the internet, the argument has always been on money. That's why I had to read that scripture, the law of Christ, Galatians 6:2. Bear one another's, you know, burden. In so doing, you fulfill what? People who argue about that don't even bear one another's burden. Because the one that suits them is the one that blesses them. How can you be comfortable in a place, things are moving on, and you are not contributing? Praise the Lord. Do you see why God says, I sought for a man to stand in the gap? Because being a man is not just wearing trousers. When I talk about man, I talk about men and women. Oh, praise the Lord. I know you people are excited now, but let me hit you small. So I can balance the equation. Amen? If you look at me anyhow, I'll fly back again immediately. Better be careful. Amen? Learn to be a responsible son and daughter. Somebody was saying, how can God be requesting? One guy was saying nonsense. How can God be requesting for his children? Before he can do something for his children, he will request them to give to him. And I said, listen, when you are young, you are not obligated to your parents. But as you get old, as you get mature, nobody will tell you to send money for your parents to go to hospital. Yes. Nobody will tell you to buy food items. Responsibility is a symbol of maturity. Yes. So don't tell yourself, does God need to tell you? No. Because if you give that example, I will tell you that it comes to a stage, even though my father was okay by all standards, we still had to send him money because we felt that this man has labored for us every month, give an income. Because we wanted him to be comfortable because they did everything to make you comfortable. So how much more in the kingdom? Oh, you don't need to give to God, but listen to me. What we are dealing with here is the house of God. We don't use urine to run generator. Ask them. So generator, people can pee inside generator tank. And before you know it, the generator will start every Sunday. Pastor, come, oh, your urine is anointed. Come and pee inside the generator. Nobody does that. These things are costing in the kingdom. Show responsibility. Why? Because God wants to bless you. And because God wants to bless you, God wants to see you as somebody he can trust with certain dimensions of blessing. He will say, Dangote, does he tithe? Because, can you give what they give? Because there's not an African, he come and give $60 million for AIDS. That is even the kind of kingdom giving we talk about. Praise the Lord. When I talk this, a lot of people feel very uncomfortable. I can sense their spirit in this place. Don't feel uncomfortable, praise the Lord. I'm just telling you the truth. Because if you cut certain covenants with God, things will become easy. There are people who are not crying that Nigeria is like this. There are people who don't even know everything in Nigeria. There are people, they don't even, Nigeria, so I don't even understand what you're talking about. Because they are loaded to the hilt. Not even because you have a bank balance that is so high, but any need you have, God will meet it. Somehow. Why? Because you have learned to put your trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. In all your ways, acknowledge him. And he will do what? Direct. Somebody say direct. Let God be your director in 2024. It is not late yet. Because all the prophecies will give. People go to other places and they get, you know, results, you know, because of the things we say. How much more a house that you dwell in? Don't become too familiar with the anointing. Praise the Lord. Tell your neighbor, don't become too familiar with the anointing. Anytime you respect the grace of God upon a man of God, his words become his merchandise. Shelley, as long as he preaches scripture. Once we preach scripture, you know, I mentioned to somebody, I said the other day, you say, yeah, pastor, what content do you have? You don't have content. Pastor, is this somebody who just comes and starts telling you what you're wearing in your this thing? The pastor must have some pasture that people will feed on. What content? You've not built yourself up. You don't know the scriptures. And I told him, frankly, you need to build content. Because that's why people say that there are a lot of false prophets around. Why? Because there's no content. You can't disprove knowledge, sound doctrine. When people speak with sound doctrine. You see, all these things we're arguing on the social media, everybody is fully persuaded in what is preaching, though. If we start bringing out, some people will argue, if we start bringing out scriptures, people will say, eh? Where is it in the Bible? Show me. Because you know it. It's not somebody's narrative that you're preaching. It's not reported speech. Say what God has said to you. Amen? I can do all things through Christ. If I woke up tomorrow morning now, this thing I'm preaching now, I will say it to myself. Pastor, do you have a lot of things you are thinking about? Of course. But I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. As I do it, I'm putting on my beautiful garment. As I'm putting on my beautiful garment, I'm chasing away the uncircumcised. And all the things that the enemy wants to latch on me. And I'm saying, no way. I will be what God says I am. Somebody shout aloud, amen. Amen. Let me maybe read one more scripture and I close. It says, do not be weary. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 9. It says, do not be weary in well doing. Because you shall reap if you faint not. Tell your neighbor, do not be weary in well doing. Because in due season, there's a due season, you will reap. If, conditional word, if you faint not. In other words, when you are doing good, there's a likelihood that you can faint. Especially when results don't come immediately. So the Bible is telling you it's not unusual, amen, to be doing good every time you come for choir practice. And you have expectations. That word is actually for you, for both of you. And you come for choir practice, you have expectations. But I should tell you, do not be weary in well doing. There's a due season. Let me tell you, what God can do in a day, he can do in 1,000 years. Yeah. No, let me tell you, let me put it this way. What God can do in 1,000 years, he can do in one day. Do you know why? Because the Bible said that 1,000 years is like one day in the sight of God. So God is not somebody you can constrain to a box. What 1,000 generations can get, he can do it in one day. He can give you a child, give you a car, give you a house, people who came to hear your testimony will bring all manner of things. I have seen things in this life that I can't doubt God. Stop telling me that God cannot give you money miraculously. God can give you money miraculously. What are you telling me? Mike Murdock said one day he met one of these basketballers in flight. And the basketballer saw him and said, Mike Murdock, I've listened to your message. They've been a tremendous blessing to me. The guy went inside his suit pocket, bringing bundles of notes. Why would a man carry that kind of money in his suit pocket? Because naturally, if you had that kind of money, you put it in your bag. Or better still, America is a cashless society. But there was something God wanted to do in the life of Mike. And he said, immediately he got in there, the man was bringing it out and giving it to him. That is miracle money.
Yes, sir.
Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to say miracle money is for lazy. Who told you? Don't limit God. God can do anything.
Yes,
stop arguing about things you don't know. I don't limit God here. Praise the Lord. My heart is open to receiving from God from every angle. And my heart is open. There's absolutely nothing God cannot do.
Yes, sir.
I was appointed, let me share this before I close, to come back 2 days to my return to Nigeria. We went to work out. 2 days. I've been praying. Every day I wake up and pray. 3 a.m. All the time I was in the U.S. Every day I wake up. I don't eat in the night. So that I can be able to wake up. I try to sleep early. Sometimes I can't sleep early. But I wake up by 3. It became part of me. I will pray. And what did God tell you to pray? 1 hour prayer. Not any 1 hour. I did it consistently. Consistently, God didn't speak. That's why I told you I thought I knew God. Because I felt God would speak to me in a particular way. I told God I'm not ready. In fact, when I went to dig up documents for our ministry, that ministry started in 2014. 10 years. So it wasn't even about ambition. If you said the pastor wants to, because in America, why don't you open to his village? Ask God to forgive you. Ask God to for what? Ask God to do what? Forgive me. Let my tongue not put me in trouble. Many of you can be called today. Go to that place that God has called you. We know where God has called us, and that's why we are operating with that level of grace. 2014, I applied for 501c tax exemptions. But as a non-profit, you're not supposed to pay tax. And they gave me 2015. The whole letters are there. Because I didn't do anything, I have to activate it again. It has been moribund by, you know, the Secretary of State in Texas. So, 2 days. 2 days. That's why I said God can do on a basketball court. Because they go to play lawn tennis while I do some running or walking. I told him, I'm leaving in 2 days. So, Apostle, you can't go. This somebody I've been seeing every day for the number of period I've stayed there. Just about going. When I'm about to go. And let me tell you, I lost a suitcase. That's the story for another day, because these things were the things that made me tarry more. Amen? Because, you see, you would think you know God. You don't know him. I don't know God. I'm humble enough to admit I don't know God. I thought I knew him. 2 days. And these guys were not like, you know, prophets. Because we are waiting for that prophet that you've been sending seed to speak. That God will not speak to that prophet. God will shock you. The guy will not say, man of God, I hope you are remembering me in prayers. Yes, he doesn't remember you. He doesn't remember you, because God wants you to put your trust in him. Do you know? This apostle, no, you can't go. You have to do a session with us. I said, how? I want to say, please do. Go and look for Marriott. Marriott could have even been about $3,000. Was already to bankroll it. But because it was about July 4th, all the Marriotts were booked because it was America's independence. So they said, I should go to, I went to get a beautiful place. The place went beautiful place and paid. I was trying to be humble. I said, this is too much. We can use that. I said, Apostle, do your work. Let me do my work.
Glory.
That is the kind of thing I want from you people.
Yes.
Not that I'll be doing my own work, I'll be doing also the work you're supposed to do. What time will I spend in prayer? Or fasting? Pray. Praise the Lord. Amen. Do you still love me?
Yes,
sir. So I'll close now. That was how. Apostle, I'll pay for this. I'll pay for your change of ticket. I'll pay for everything. Don't worry.
Oh,
that's how I see I've reached now. In the most simple way, God acted. I don't need to beg. People are just, some of them are watching online, I'm sure. Because they had to tune into service today, praise the Lord. What I'm telling you this is that any day you hear the voice of God, harden not your heart. Because something big is ahead. God has been dropping something in your heart. You are feeling, I won't do it. People are doing many, many mighty things. I fear God. The testimonies I've heard from them within the period, if I came here, is outstanding. People say, you can't give. No lie. You can give to be blessed.
Yes.
I'm telling me, what you make happen for God, God will not make happen for you. Something has been hanging. Licenses that have not been approved have been approved. Why? Because somebody dared to believe God. These people I'm telling you are not too spiritual. You know, we get too spiritual and confuse ourselves.
Yes.
Stop, you know, saying I'm spiritual, all these unbelievers. The unbelievers even obey God more than believers. Believers will be dotting the I's, crossing the T's, thinking about revelation, thinking about in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Every word is established. Somebody has heard God and move with it. It's a different story. Things are simple. I have seen God, but not in the way I thought I would see him. God bless you all.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. If you were blessed by the message and you would like us to pray with you, or you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, feel free to write to us via email, mails@harvesterscity@gmail.com, and we will respond immediately. This message was brought to you by Harvester City. God bless you, real good.
So let the church
say.